Anyone who travels the Alaska Highway today for the first time would be hard put to imagine the hardships associated with the building of the road. Today, one whizzes by on a paved highway in modern cars, trucks, and campers, past clean modern motels, cafes, and towns. In the early 1940s, this was mostly wilderness, traveled by a small band of hunters, trappers, and prospectors, and several Indian tribes. The mile upon mile of desolate countryside and harsh weather conditions continued to make this area hostile to modern development. Even today, the road can be very inhospitable at times, and the area just off the highway is still very remote and rugged. We can thank, in part, the cooperation of the United States and Canadian governments for building the road and bringing it to the condition it is in now for the tourists traveling to Canada and Alaska. It has undoubtedly vastly increased the modernization of the North Country, which may, in fact, be considered a sin to some of the old-timers in the area. Our trip up the highway starts at mile zero at Dawson Creek, British Columbia, just over the border from Alberta. Dawson Creek was a small frontier town and the end of the railhead in the spring of 1942. Today, it is a modern city in the heart of the Peace River country. Ahead of us lies 1,500 miles of adventure. From Dawson Creek, the highway winds north to Taylor, across the Peace River Bridge and through Fort St. John, the largest city between Dawson Creek and Whitehorse. At kilometer 305, mile 162, we pass the Sicanee Chief Bridge, one of the few remaining 1943 bridges still in existence. The highway now bypasses it. The highway has to have constant maintenance, and it is still being rerouted in places. In 1988, a large section of the Trutch area was realigned for much better driving. At kilometer 465, mile 300, we pass through the old Hudson's Bay town of Fort Nelson, now a modern city in northern British Columbia. A modern museum has recently opened with many interesting historical displays. The highest point of the highway is reached at Summit at kilometer 621, mile 392, at an elevation of 1,295 meters or 4,250 feet. From here, we go through some of the most beautiful scenery on the highway at Stone Mountain Park, and along Muncho Lake. Many roadhouses along the highway offer most of the comforts of home, including home-baked breads and sweets. Animals can be seen along the highway at many locations. The Liard River Bridge is located near Liard Hot Springs Park, where we can take a dip in the hot pools, the same area used by the soldiers over 40 years ago. At Contact Creek, kilometer 945, mile 567, we cross the bridge, marking the location of the meeting of construction crews from east and west on September 25th, 1942, closing 900 miles of highway construction between Dawson Creek and Whitehorse. The Yukon is entered soon afterwards, and Watson Lake is our first major stop in the territory at kilometer 1020, mile 612.
I'm Carl Lindley, and I'm from Danville, Illinois, and I'm the 341st Engineers Company D, and we were stationed at Upper Liard River in 1943, and we were sent down to Lower Post to do a repair job on the road, and we were building a loading platform. And building a loading platform, I had my feet run over, and I laid up for 2 or 3 weeks in the aid station here at Watson Lake intersection. And later on, after I got to walking around a little bit, the company commander asked me if I could repair and repaint an old sign that was there, which was had several different countries and cities located on it. And bulldozer had been pushed it off the road. And I took that old sign and repaired it and made it so it was pretty good shape. And then I put my own sign of Danville, Illinois on it. And then I went back to the company and started painting trucks, putting markings on trucks and so forth, getting ready to come back to the States. We had a lot of work to do there at Upper Liard River. We run a sawmill and build a bridge back in there after the thaw. I returned in 1992 and found something that I couldn't believe. All the signs up there, there's close to 20,000 signs up there at the present time. And I replaced and a sign that I'd painted years ago and put it on this old signpost that they had repaired for it. And the sign force has drawn many attractions. A lot of tourists stop in there, and they all want to know what it's all about. It's an interesting place for everybody to travel.
The next 300 miles of highway winds its way through the rugged country of the Yukon and dips again into British Columbia. At Johnson's Crossing, kilometer 1346, mile 836, is a dump of vehicles and debris left over from the wartime Canoil oil pipeline project, which was built along with the Alaska Highway. At kilometer 1487, mile 894, we come to the capital of the Yukon, Whitehorse, a modern city of over 20,000. This is a good place to rest and take in the sights or head south to the gold rush town of Skagway, Alaska, another important town during the highway construction days. From Whitehorse, the road follows an old wagon road trail to the Kalani area through the Indian village of Champaign to Haines Junction, where the Haines Cutoff Highway connects to the Alaska Highway. And another interesting interpretive center for the massive Kalani National Park is located here. At Canyon Creek, the only remaining original bridge from 1942 has been preserved. Just off the south end of the Kalani Lake are the remains of Silver City, a major construction campsite during the war. Along the shores of the Kalani Lake, just past Slim's River, is Soldier Summit, the site of the official opening dedication of the highway in November of 1942, just 9 months after construction began. The road now follows along the shore of the lake. Destruction Bay and Burwash Landing, along with a monument to one of the soldiers who died during the construction days, are passed. as we wind our way through the Yukon and into the state of Alaska. After passing Northway Junction and Tetlin Junction, we reach Toke Junction, where the highway splits south to Anchorage and west to Fairbanks. An interpretive center is located at Toke, along with a tourist stop that raises sled dogs.
Nearest the sled, the dog we got for that position is Buddy, a 2-year-old male Alaskan Husky. Folks might want to say goodbye to these passengers. You may never see them again.
At kilometer 2288, mile 1422, we reach Delta Junction and another interesting interpretive center. The famous Trans-Alaska Pipeline passes through the area. Delta Junction is at the intersection of the old Richardson Highway from Fairbanks to Valdez and the Alaska Highway. 100 miles to the northwest lies Fairbanks in the golden heart of Alaska's interior and the official end of the Alaska Highway and our journey north. Now, let's learn about the building of the highway through the camera of this wartime U.S. Army Signal Corps movie.
When the Japs bombed Pearl Harbor, they upset our thinking about a great many things, including Alaska. Most people, if they thought of Alaska at all, thought of it as a cold, rugged wasteland, of little value except for its gold, fur, and fisheries. Now, suddenly, it seemed to have considerable additional value, both to us and to the Japanese. And its strategic position was not comforting. Alaska, the Aleutian Islands, stretched out invitingly toward a shrewd and daring enemy. The great Japanese air and naval base at Paramushiro was only 750 miles from Attu. Attu was only 1,200 miles from the mainland of Alaska. And Japs in Alaska would be a direct threat to the west coast of America and also to the interior. Alaska's long and broken coastline was weakly defended. Our bases were few and far between. And our only means of supplying them was by sea or by air. There was no overland connection across the wilderness of northwestern Canada. Not even a trail. If our shipping lanes could be interrupted, Alaska might fall. The situation called for immediate action. The Canadian government had already carved out a series of 5 airports between Edmonton, Alberta, and Whitehorse, Yukon Territory. And there were other fields in Alaska between the Yukon border and Fairbanks. With Canada's consent, the United States War Department decided to build a military highway from Rail's End at Dawson Creek, British Columbia, to Fairbanks, Alaska, to link up and supply these airfields and to provide emergency access to Alaska for troops and materiel. This highway would extend roughly 1,500 miles, about the distance from Washington to Denver. The frontier town of Dawson Creek saw the arrival of the 1st Army Engineer Troops in March 1942. Here they set up a camp. Enlisted men were trained in the special problems of maintenance and operation of tractors in the north. Their stiff workouts in sub-zero weather over the surrounding hills soon produced skilled cat skinners. the arrival of additional engineer troops, these first troops moved out over a trail broken by the Canadian Department of Transport to Fort Nelson, where they established a base camp and began working northwest. Other regiments entered the Yukon through Skagway and established a base at Whitehorse. They began working both northwest and southeast. Still other regiments entered Alaska at Valdez and moved up to a point in the interior. From here, they began working toward Fairbanks and toward the Yukon border. In all, there were 7 engineer regiments, or about 10,000 men. Their immediate job was to break through a pioneer road, a road without frills, but a road which could be used to supply the airfields and to construct a permanent road later. In summer, the troops hacked, cut, and gouged their way through the wilderness. There were colored as well as white troops. Both did their full share. They cut around mountainsides and across valleys. They corduroyed and filled over swampy ground. They slithered in the mud of thawing ground frost. They built culverts over brooks and small streams. They built bridges over mountain torrents and full-fledged rivers. Finally, on the 20th of November, 1942, 8 months after the first troops plunged into the northern bush, the pioneer road from Dawson Creek to Fairbanks was officially opened. The freight rolled through. Truck drivers were surprised to find that the road was much better than they expected. In fact, considering its length, more than 1,500 miles, the difficulties of terrain and climate, and the remarkably short time of construction, it was one of the wonders of the modern world. Northern Terminus, founded 40 years ago as a gold mining camp, was already a modern little American city in the heart of the Alaskan wilderness. Of course, the highway was still largely a winter road, usable in some sections only when the ground was frozen. Its bridges were temporary, and many of them would be washed out by the ice and floods in the spring. Even during the winter, bridges over active streams were sometimes covered by ice, and logs had to be laid across them and cemented in place by water to keep the trucks from breaking through. And there were other hazards. Active springs built up mounds of ice that had to be fought constantly. When culverts plugged up and ice mushroomed over the road, it had to be cleared, even at 40 below. Or a truck might stall in a rut or ditch where ice was forming, and while the driver went for help, it would be frozen fast. At many points, the grades were too steep, especially when they became icy. Machines worked constantly, but it was impossible to keep the road safe at all times and places. Even on the best sections, if drivers relaxed for a moment, they might find themselves in a ditch. Worked the clock round, patrolling up and down the highway, dragging trucks out of trouble whenever they found them. Control stations established at 100-mile intervals were manned by quartermaster troops, who checked over and refueled each truck as it came through. Troops had to repair and service their equipment as best they could, but repair facilities were badly overtaxed. Both spare parts and mechanics were scarce. Many trucks were deadlined for weeks at a time. At the start, troops working on the highway had only tents for living quarters. By the beginning of 1943, however, most of them were living in quonset huts. Sometimes, for added warmth, they were banked with sawdust. They came in sections and could be erected in a few hours. Following closely behind the soldiers who built the pioneer road, came civilian contractors to turn it into a permanent all-weather road. They established their own camps and repair facilities at vantage points along the route. Public Roads Administration surveyors to relocate and improve the alignment of the road. There were skilled crews with power shovels to widen the road and cut down grades. There were crews with trucks to haul gravel from the borrow pits, which were opened all up and down the highway. surface trucks to build up the road. There were bulldozers to spread and pack the gravel. And dozers to dig drainage ditches. There were motor graders to smooth the surface. There were skilled structural workers and carpenters to build permanent bridges, replacing the temporary ones of the engineers. On the rivers, strange new patterns in steel rose against the cold northern sky. There were telephone crews to put in a line stretching the entire length of the highway. The Signal Corps directed the work, and its men did the pioneering. This activity demanded a constant flow of supplies, both up the highway and by sea. The Japs, although they had been entrenched in the Aleutian since June of 1942, were unable to interfere with coastwise shipping to Alaska. So it was possible to increase the volume of supplies moving in through Skagway. Was built up as the gateway to the fabulous Klondike during the gold rush of 97 and 98, when gamblers and desperados like Soapy Smith held sway. Then it became a ghost town, surviving only as a small port and railroad terminal, attracting a few hundred tourists each summer. Suddenly it came to life again as a transfer point for troops and supplies for the Alaska Highway. Port facilities were improved and enlarged. The wharf was extended. Freighters coming up the inside passage from Prince Rupert in British Columbia could be unloaded quickly and easily. Barges could be beached and unloaded at low tide. From Skagway, supplies moved across the mountains on the narrow-gauge White Pass and Yukon Railway. This winding railway is one of the steepest in the world. It follows closely the famous Trail of 98, on which many a man lost his life climbing its icy ledges on his way to the Klondike. To make sure the railway would continue to operate during the emergency, the Army leased it and installed a railroad operating battalion to run it. All winter long, in spite of cold and snow and treacherous rock slides, these trainmen in uniform kept supplies and equipment rolling steadily the 110 miles into Whitehorse. As an example of the railroad troops' devotion to duty, one engineer was awarded the Soldier's Medal for risking his life to save a train from destruction. Whitehorse, at the head of navigation on the Yukon River, 40 years ago in its gold rush heyday, boasted a population of 20,000 people, which later dwindled to a few hundred. Now it was reawakening to the unfamiliar voices of soldiers and truck drivers and cat skinners. Through the spring and summer, the road building continued. By now, there were 81 contractors and about 14,000 men scattered along the highway. Crews worked in two shifts of sometimes 10 and sometimes 11 hours each. Specifications call for a 26-foot roadbed with 20 to 22 feet of surfacing with gravel or crushed stone. In addition to the highway itself, an important supplement was being built, the Haines Cutoff. Running from Haines in the Alaska Panhandle, 160 miles north to a point on the highway 95 miles west of Whitehorse, the cutoff was designed to relieve the strain on the White Pass and Yukon Railway. It was begun in the spring of 1943, with engineer troops pioneering the road south from the Alaska Highway. At the same time, civilian contractors started north from Chilkoot Barracks, an early military post which lay just outside the village of Haines. For the first 42 miles, an old motor road was improved, widened, and in places relocated. On its way to the Alaska-Yukon border, this road wound through spruce and poplar forests, over cold mountain streams, and through a sleepy Indian village. Northward, the route followed an old pack trail. Here the contractors started from scratch, clearing timber, grading, and surfacing. On reaching the pioneer road of the engineers, the civilian crews continued along it, improving and widening it all the way to the main highway. When the Haines Cutoff was finished in the fall of 1943, the Alaska Highway had an all-weather connection with Tidewater. As the highway and the cutoff were nearing completion, so were the emergency flight strips being built by the Canadian Department of Transport and the United States Army Engineers. Were spaced between airports to provide a safe landing surface for pilots who suddenly ran into trouble. In addition, the engineers were improving the airports themselves. Extra hangars were built. New runways and aprons were added. Airports were enlarged and the flight strips were built not only to speed American planes into Alaska, but also to service Red Starred fighters and bombers being ferried on Lend-Lease direct to Russia. At the same time, most of the 86 major bridges on the highway were being finished. The largest of these was the Peace River Bridge, spanning one of the great rivers of the North. Near the southern end of the highway, the bridge is 2,275 feet long, with two suspension towers reaching 200 feet high, and a concrete deck 24 feet wide. The bridge was officially opened in August 1943. Soldiers and construction workers came from various sections of the highway. There were officers and officials representing both the United States and Canada. There were speeches. There was a ribbon to be cut. But the crowd didn't need to be told of the importance of the occasion. The towering bridge itself was ample evidence of the new day dawning in the North. Now the lower half of the highway was finished. In all seasons, trucks from Dawson Creek could travel straight through to Whitehorse. At intervals of about 100 miles, there were relay stations where the trucks were checked over and refueled. In the pioneering days, most of the fuel used on the highway was trucked from railhead at Dawson Creek or brought up the inside passage in tankers to Skagway. But with the completion of the Canal project, with its refinery and network of pipelines, the Alaska Highway had its own fueling system. Oil from Norman Wells was refined at Whitehorse, and gasoline was pumped through supplementary pipelines to all points on the highway from Watson Lake to Fairbanks. By October 1943, there was only one gap left in the highway. It was just east of the Alaska-Yukon border. On the 13th of October, the remaining gap was only a few hundred feet. There were two crews working toward each other. In this section, there was permanent ground frost. That meant the ground stayed frozen all summer long, down to a depth of 50 or 60 feet. If the surface cover of moss and vegetation were disturbed, the ground would quickly thaw and become a quagmire. So the contractors used a road building technique peculiar to the north. Rock fill and gravel were spilled out on the ground and carefully spread over the surface. In this way, insulation was added to that already provided by nature, and the frost was permanently locked in. When the end was in sight, the truck drivers and cat skinners, the foremen and superintendents felt the growing excitement. They were witnessing the climax of 20 long months of toil by 25,000 men. It was 6 o'clock. The sun was down. The bulldozers moved in. Their blades touched. The Alaska Highway was finished. A handshake in the gloom of an autumn evening marked the end. This is the road these men built. And this is a good road, as good as any graveled road in the world. Better in alignment and grades than any road of comparable length on this continent. The Alaska Highway is much more than a road, much more than a brilliant construction feat. It is the backbone of our military position in the far northwest. Its smooth surface provides a safe all-weather route for trucks and cars from the transportation network of southern Canada to the interior of Alaska. Through the 1,600 miles of integrated canal pipelines, fuel to supply the road, the airports, and the flight strips is readily available. Now we can press home the attack. This is the road through the brooding wilderness. This is the wedge which has pried open the last great frontier of America. The key which has unlocked the treasure chest of Alaska and the Canadian Northwest.
The Pioneer Road had been punched through the wilderness in record time. But in early 1943, the Public Roads Administration had the job of upgrading the road to a year-round passable condition with widths of 26 to 32 feet. Grades had to be reduced and straightened. New road beds had to be built across the many swampy sections, and permanent bridges had to be built. This was no easy task, and the same problems that faced the builders of the Pioneer Road also faced the PRA men. As the original construction regiments were pulled off the project in early to mid-1943, private contractors were hired by the Public Roads Administration to do the reconstruction. Although the PRA had been on the job since its inception, more than 16,000 civilian construction workers employed by American and Canadian companies were now on the job. PRA offices were set up in Fort St. John and Whitehorse to direct the construction, with other small offices scattered along the route. Five major contractors were hired to oversee the construction. Each in turn subcontracted with individual companies for certain parts of the job. In addition, highly technical contractors were hired for the large bridge projects. No one had any idea how long it was to take to bring the road up to a standard for safe travel, due to the many variables of weather and supply problems. More than 70 companies were involved in the reconstruction project. By 1943, the threat of a Japanese invasion had waned due to reversals on all war fronts in the Pacific. The need for the highway was not as critical as during the early days of 1942. The United States Army was responsible for maintenance of the road, but by 1944, the workforce was reduced to between 300 and 500 men, all Canadian civilians. The idea of building an all-weather highway with high standards was abandoned for the time being, and only essential relocation work was authorized, with all work by the PRA to be phased out by the end of October 1943. The problems encountered by the initial construction crews were inherited by the civilian workers, especially the icing conditions and washouts. Bridges were a continual problem. Dozens were washed out in 1943 and 1944. It was a constant battle to keep the highway open with the adverse weather conditions, limited funding, and manpower. 6 months after the war was over, the Americans were to turn the highway over to Canadian authorities. In April of 1946, the Royal Canadian Army officially took over operation and maintenance of the road. There was little usable construction equipment left, and only a small workforce to oversee the 1,200 miles of road in Canada. There was an immediate need to upgrade the road and bridges, as there was pressure to open the road to civilian use. Civilian traffic was restricted in 1946 and 1947. The road was open for a time in 1948, but had to close because of the high number of car breakdowns. By 1949, the highway was opened on a full-time basis, with tourist facilities being expanded every year thereafter. April 1, 1964, saw the highway's military administration come to an end, and the Department of Public Works took over the Canadian portion of the road. The Alaska portion was maintained by the Alaska Road Commission. The total cost of the road was over $138 million and required the placement of 133 bridges and 8,000 culverts.
The 97th Engineers was a general service regiment with all black troops and white officers. I was a lieutenant in A Company of the 97th Engineers. We went to Seattle and boarded a troop transport called the David W. Branch, and embarked for Valdez, Alaska. up the inside passageway. When we arrived at Valdez, there was too much snow in the mountains in the Coast Range for us to go inland, so we camped for almost a month at 13 mile out of Valdez on what is now, and it was then, the Richardson Highway. When we first started building the road, I mentioned that our men were completely inexperienced, and so were the officers. And we had two men from the Caterpillar Company with us, and even they were inexperienced for field work. I literally spent days putting the tracks back on a D8 up to this point I'm talking about now, and we lost a lot of time. We tried to run them back on by running the tracks forward and backing off the, what you call the bogey wheel. I accidentally discovered right after that, having a track off up on the side of a icy mountain, that the way to put a track on a D8 was to back it down and turn it slowly away from the track it was off, and the track would run itself on. And everybody in the regiment had been playing this for, you say, weeks or actually months, from June up to into August. And this saved a lot of time after that, because we learned how to put the track back on the D8.
The group of men you see coming off the train from Edmonton are on their way to Camp Number 5 near Whitehorse. That sector of the telephone line was assigned to the Oman Smith Company. After a night's sleep at the Miller Main Camp in Dawson Creek, they will be loaded on a convoy bound for Whitehorse over the Alcan Highway. They will soon find out the trip across Canada was nothing compared to what they will see the next week. Many wrecked trucks are seen along the way. Hit pole dollies dropping poles along the highway and crews working on the right-of-way. Finally arriving at Camp Base Camp for Roman Smith at McRae Crossing. This was also the main camp for Bechtel, Price and Callahan, the prime contractor for the Cano project. It didn't take long, and they were working, cutting spruce trees, trimming, drilling holes for cross arms, heading out to clear brush, and get the right-of-way ready for the crews to set poles and string wire. And of course, you can only look at the girls, but that's all. There were hundreds of trucks in the main motor pool. All convoys were strictly checked by the highway patrol at special checkpoints along the road. A feeder line was laid into Crocra, a small village off the Alaska Highway. And they had their fun too. Here you see them unloading beer in Whitehorse. In those days, tap beer was unheard of in Far North Country. The bottles were all wrapped and put in wooden barrels, then packed with straw, and then shipped by trucks all over the territory. Isn't that a beautiful mounted police? The Northwest Canadian Mounted Police with those colorful uniforms? They were ever present, but you know, they really had little to do. There was very little crime in the North Country in those days. A glimpse of how pipe was loaded on barges and shipped up to the Cano project. Thank you. There's the airfield at Whitehorse, and it was a busy place, a stepping stone for planes being ferried to Russia. More scenes of the telephone line right of way. Hey, do you notice that big truck pulling that small one out of the water? That's a super-powered White, made by the White Motor Company. And as usual, the Army made a bad mistake. They were built for the desert campaign and instead were shipped to Alaska. Had single tandem wheels, useless for muskeg and mud. Many were wrecked on their first trip out. There's a picture of Soldier Summit, where the two construction battalions met on November 20th, 1942, tied the two sections of the highway together. A big dance and get-together on a special Sunday at the big Cano camp at McRae. Everyone was always invited, even the Army band. During the construction of the Alcan, there were two major fires that caused a great deal of damage. The one at Dawson Creek, 1943, which destroyed almost the complete center of town. Thank you.